Good morning. I am corralling you this morning. So I've noticed a thing, and that is that you guys really, really like one another. A whole lot. So much so that when you come in, it's hard to get you settled in this room at 10:30. And our worship often doesn't get to start until you're settled down at like 10:35, or you make your way in from getting your last cup of coffee or chatting with friends. So we're gonna change the order of things a little bit in the morning so that folks aren't coming in during our musical performances or during the chalice lighting. So we're gonna begin with our announcements. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Davis. My name is Reverend Connie Simon, and I am honored to be your interim minister and your worship leader, associate, and facilitator for today's service. For thousands of years, the land upon which we are gathered has been the home of the Patwin people, including the Yotadehi Winton Nation today. Easy for me to say. The Patwin people have remained committed to the stewardship of this land over many centuries. It has been cherished and protected as elders have instructed the young through generations. We are honored and grateful to be gathered here today on their traditional lands. If this is your first time here today in person, we welcome you. We hope you will stop by the welcome table so that we can get to know you and get you connected to things happening here at UUCD. For our online community, if this is your first time here or you're not yet connected to the newsletter, please look for a message from our online welcome host or send a message to the person with welcome in their name. If you are watching on Zoom, please know that you have the order of service and the music for the hymns in your email. We come together in many ways this morning. Let's take a moment to connect with those folks on Zoom. Hey, Zoom folks. Hey. Let's see. Oh, I see lots of folks out there. Good morning, everybody. However you are joining us this morning, please leave the door open behind you, inviting others to enter as well. And now we'll hear from the search committee.
We're searching. Good morning from your friendly, hardworking, fabulous ministerial search team. We are Alex Lee Job, Lorraine Vischer, Jose Torres, Mark Eschbach, Tamara Range, and Jill Pickett. Your search team wants to hear from all of you. We are seeking your input so we can find the very best minister for you. We will do this by this ways, the online survey. If you haven't filled out your survey, please fill it out.
You have one more week. 1 week.
1 week. Number two, search parties, which are coming up 3 dates in October. Thursday, October 12th, 7 to 8, dessert will be served. Sunday, October 22nd, 12 to 1, lunch will be served. October 29th, Sunday, 12 to 1, lunch will be served there too. Plus, we have focus group meetings also coming up this day. Here comes Jose Torres. Also, focus group meetings are coming up in October. Plus, we have a B4, which stands for Building Bridges, Breaking Barriers, Training, coming up Saturday, November 4th. that you're all invited to. A facilitator is being sent by the UUA to our church to do this training for us. So it would be really wonderful if as many of you as possible can come, and lunch will be served. So.
Only if they sign up though, right?
Yes, but you gotta sign up so we'll have enough food. All right, that's my message for today. Thank you, everyone.
Good morning. We are lucky this morning to hear from Susan Coppock and Virginia Thigpen. And if you like what you hear, which I'm sure you will, there's an opportunity to sign up in the auction, the UUCD auction, for a concert this Saturday, this coming Saturday at 4 o'clock to 6 o'clock in the Romani Mansion down the street. If you have, it's a beautiful venue, and if you haven't been there, it's worth coming, and there's going to be food and beverages and wonderful people and beautiful music. So let's center through music right now, but you can go on to that online auction. You can find it in your bulletin. So see you there.
Let's center through music.
Lots of things I like about ministry. And one of them is that I get to see lots of things when they happen in this space. Like Angelita's face watching the harp with Lou with her arm around her. Wish I'd had a camera for that. That's an image I will never forget. And now, with some help from Cyprus and Gia, we're going to light our chalice. You ready? Okay, we're ready. In the name of all that is holy, may the connections between us inspire us and sustain us. May the flame of life within us and amongst us be a sacred reminder that we are all called to serve, to grow, and to love as we continue this journey of transformation. Yay, you did a great job. And now please rise in body or spirit as you are willing and able, and let's sing hymn 1008, When Our Heart Is in a Holy Place.
When our heart is in a holy place.
ages. And I would like to invite any young at heart or just anybody who wants to come down for a story. Come on down. I know. I'm going to put you to work today. Okay. So, there's a test. You probably didn't know there was a test. You knew. I know you knew because I told you, Tobias. Okay. Does anybody know what this is?
Yes.
Yes? What is it?
It's for your necklace.
It's for my necklace? Okay. Any other guesses?
It's a stole.
And what is that?
It's something that ministers wear.
Oh. Why do ministers wear a stole? Does anybody know? Billy, why do I wear a stole?
I say for any other color, it would probably look gorgeous.
Well, yeah. Yeah, it is a fashion thing for me.
Not for you, anyone who wears that type of vest.
Okay, do anyone. Because you got the colors working today, too. Any other ideas why ministers wear stoles? Do you know where we get them from?
No.
Where do you get them from?
Church.
Unique artists? Amazing artists? Where do you think you get them from?
They're usually presents from congregations.
Presents from congregations. Well, it happens this one was a present from a congregation. So, yes, it's called a stole. And it is a symbol, or what's called a vestment. And in different faiths, they look like different things. So sometimes you might see Catholic priests wearing all kinds of stuff. Yeah, you can touch it. And all kinds of stuff all over theirs. You might see them wearing big hats and belts and, okay, and all kinds of things on them. This one.
Yes, so, sometimes the hats of Christians are topped with a cross.
Yes, exactly. Sometimes their hats resemble the top of the cross.
Like the cross where Christ died.
Exactly. That's exactly it. What's on mine? Do you know what this is?
Trees and birds.
Trees and birds. Is there anything in Unitarian Universalism that you can think of that has trees and birds?
Outside.
Any songs you can think of? Spirit of life.
You just sang it.
Oh, I gave it away. So this was a gift to me from my congregation because when I decided I was going to become a minister, I had to stop being a regular member. Ministers can't be regular members. We're different. So when I was about to leave, I thanked them for giving me my roots in Unitarian Universalism and my wings to fly into ministry. So they made me this stole and gave it to me at my ordination as a presentation of their, as a symbol of their love. Now, what's special about stoles is that on the inside, you can't see it, but the congregations write notes to you. They write wishes and blessings for you. So when this was being made, my friend Reverend Abby made this for me. She had a piece, there's a piece of what's called interfacing in here, and she let everybody write their good wishes for me. And then she covered it up with the fabric so that I can never see them, but I'm always carrying their love with me. And on the back, this is a picture of the stained glass window that hangs in the church. Well, it doesn't hang, it's built into the wall. See? It's a big, it's a big, big, big church, and it has a big window. And at night, it's really, really colorful. And at night, all these little angels, their faces become brown. So they call it Connie's Angel. Because I used to just sit and talk to the angel all the time. So, when they give you this stole, it's a ritual. And I think you guys are gonna learn more about rituals today, aren't you? You excited about that? Okay, so when you go off to your lessons, I want you to think about rituals and how you give gifts to people. I want you to think about something else too. But first, you gotta look at some pictures with us. You ready? Okay, you ready, Thomas? Okay. So when I went to my last church, I asked the kids, I said, can you give me some advice on how to be a minister? And they drew me pictures, which is what started my love of getting drawings from you guys.
Just like me.
Just like you. You give me lots of drawings, and Genevieve gives me drawings. Duncan even did a drawing for me. So, the first one, and there's a bunch of these, but I only brought a few. The first one said, new minister, hi. Not really advice, but you know, it works. Next. This one is, I guess I'm supposed to say profane words, I'm not sure. And then there's a little drawing of me, and have lots of love in your heart, and that I should be LGBTQ friendly.
What?
That's what they told me. So all the kids came and explained what these were.
What is the LGBTQ thing?
You don't know what that means? Oh. Does anybody know what that means?
It's based on the universe.
Oh, so there are some people who love people that are perceived to be the same sex as them. So there's lesbian. No, you're not even listening to me, I'm telling you. Lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, asexual, polyamorous, anti-sex. There's a lot of them. But it talks about, it's a way to describe who you love.
Well, not asexual.
No, it is.
Totally,
I want to show everybody one.
Okay, wait a minute. We're going to talk about this some more. Now, let's look at the next picture. This advice was that I should have spiders. And I'm not sure what that meant, but the first day I got here, you told me I should have frogs. Do you remember that? You were just little then. So I guess new ministers should have spiders to be successful. Next one. This one is somebody telling me that we should play a lot. They put a drawing up in the corner of the playground at that church. And you may be wondering, like, why do all these have long hair? I used to have really long hair. I just cut it off before I came here. My hair was really long. And sometimes I'd wear it in a ponytail, sometimes in a bun, sometimes like this. So that's what those pictures are from.
Sometimes I wear a bun and a braid.
Yes. Next. This one is that I should bring my dog to church, which I do sometimes. I should have love in my heart. I should make sure that there is lots of food for the kids. Donuts and pizza. That's what they wanted. One at a time. Yes.
I remember once when you passed by the kitchen and I suddenly came out and then your dog started barking at me.
Yep. She started barking. Ridley's crazy. Okay, next. Next one. I'm not quite sure what was up with my face in this portrait, but They really, really wanted to make sure that I did the donut thing and the love thing because they have exclamation points. And this kid was really, really into peace and environmentalism. So they wanted me to love the world. And as it happened, this church was really, really old, and in the middle of the building, it had a fish pond built in. So you could be in the sanctuary, or you could be in one of the rooms, and you could look in and see all these koi fish swimming around. Well, at a different church, kind of like that. So that's why they wanted to make sure we were nice to the environment. Last one. This was my favorite. This was my favorite one, and I was a little not sure until the little kid told me, don't stab people with a knife.
We already know that.
That was the advice. Yes, Billy?
If for some reason, by the looks of what I thought of this first time when I saw this on screen, it reminds me of some of the things that you should probably not have if kids are mature enough to take care of these things. Makeup markers, beanbag chairs, and most importantly, I guess,
knives?
Really nice things.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's a thing. So let me tell you the story behind this. Afterward, the parent was so embarrassed and came up to me and said, we had some friends over for dinner, and we let the young one sit at the grown-up table. And they needed to understand that you don't stab people with the knives. They thought that the silverware was playware. So, I know, but hey, it's advice that I've carried with me for years. Don't stab people with a knife. So when you're out there doing your ritual class today and you're doing your coloring, I think you're even gonna color some stoles. I want you to start thinking about advice that you would give to the next minister, okay? And if you want, you can draw me a picture of it and we'll talk about it up here again. How's that sound?
Totally nice.
Totally nice. All right, you guys ready to go? Traveling music, Lou? Have fun. Lesson, wasn't it? Spirit of life, come unto me.
Stay in my heart, all servants of
For those we've named, for those whose names we do not know, and for those whose names are carefully guarded in our hearts, let's pause for a moment of silent meditation, reflection, and prayer. We're thinking of you, Stan and Carol. So there's another thing that's amazing about being a minister. And that's when you get to work with really, really good people. And I don't know if you're aware that a thing just happened right now. I totally changed the order of service. In the moment, because something happened. Now, I do that a lot, and sometimes you don't even know I've done it. I change sermons. I change prayers. I am completely reactive to you. If you are having a hard time, if I see that there's some phrase that has touched people in a particular way, we might go that way. That's part of what ministry is to me. And when it's just me, it's okay. But right now, you just watched Lou go from one song to another pretty easily, and you saw Thomas and Alexander pull up slides for Spirit of Life when they didn't even know we were going to sing that. Take a moment and appreciate them. So guys, we're not singing There's a River Flowing Through My Soul. We're gonna talk about ministry, if you haven't figured out. That's the theme today. And we're going to begin with a video called Calling.
Calling by Nancy Schaefer. When you heard that voice and knew, finally, that it called for you and what it was saying, where were you? Were you in the shower, wet and soapy, or chopping cabbage late for dinner? Were you planting radish seeds or seeking one lost sock? Maybe wiping handprints off a window or coaxing words into a sentence or coming upon a hyacinth or one last no. Where were you when you heard that ancient voice? And did yes get born right then? And did you weep? Had it called you since before you even were? And when you knew that, did your joy escape all holding? Where were you when you heard that calling voice? And how, in that moment, did you mark it? How, ever after, are you changed? Tell us, please, all you can about that voice. Teach us how to listen, how to hear. Teach us all you can of saying yes.
Does your heart and soul say yes? Does your spirit still say yes? Where were you when you heard that ancient voice? And did yes get born right then? And did you weep? There is more that I require of thee. Will your spirit still say yes? That was the song at my ordination. And my niece sang it. My niece is a professional singer. Backed by a choir, and then I stepped forward. And that was the answering of my call. That was the day that the Unitarian Society of Germantown and the First Unitarian Church of Philadelphia jointly ordained me as a minister. I wish I could say it was easy and it came quick, but it wasn't. It took me a while to hear my call. Oprah Winfrey once said that when God wants to talk to you, he whispers in your ear. If you don't listen, he taps you on the shoulder. If you still don't listen, he'll throw a brick upside your head. I never imagined being a minister. When I was a little girl, like a little girl, I wanted to become a cardiovascular surgeon. And then I was going to become a veterinarian, but only if I didn't have to see any of the animals die, which my mom told me was probably not going to work out. And then I was going to be a professional musician and write scores for movies. And somehow that turned into being a tax litigator. And then a corporate lawyer and a teacher, an instructor in business schools and at law school, and then a program director for a nonprofit and a realtor and a small business owner and a corporate drone for Bank of America, and then a minister. Being a minister was the furthest thing from my mind. I'd already had a law degree and another master's degree in telecommunications regulatory policy. Why on earth would I want to go back to school at nearly 50 years old? Still, the minister at my home church kept asking me, "When are you going to seminary?" Then other people started asking. Because, you know, I was the chair of the worship committee and the congregational moderator, which is a position you don't have here, but it's kind of like the president of the congregation. And just, you know, I was doing all these things and people kept saying, "When are you going to seminary?" I'm not going to seminary. And then one day, Reverend Nate looked at me and said, "You know, you're already a minister. You may as well just go get the title." And that was the brick upside my head. Will your heart and soul say yes?
Ministry is a blessing. It is the most rewarding work I could ever imagine myself doing.
One of the best parts of being a minister is just how many holy moments you get to experience in the average week.
It's work that has very tangible results. You can see somebody's day brighten. You can see the difference that you're making as a child grows up in the community. You can see the difference that it makes when you visit somebody who's sick or ill and in need of comfort and care.
I love that it is never the same. And ministry allows me to get to know people in a way that is special and intimate and really precious.
This is the only work I have ever done in my life where I get to use all of me.
One of the things I really love is being an institutional leader in an institution that changes the world, that changes lives. Like being a school principal, but in a place that makes amazing things happen.
I love that I get to do so many things. I love blessing babies. I love praying out loud.
It's the weddings and the funerals and the child dedications. It's the potluck dinners where everybody's just sitting around, plate on your laps, talking about whatever you're talking about.
Sunday morning is magic. Every Sunday when you arrive to church and you step into that pulpit and look out at your people.
I love the people. And I love preaching, and so that's a good combination. I can use everything that I like to do, writing and music and speaking and being in groups of people.
I love organizing big groups of people to do meaningful things with their lives. I love knowing that I'm doing something meaningful with my life.
I do have one regret about ministry. I didn't do it sooner.
That's an old video. You may have recognized some of those faces and thought, that's not, wait a minute, is that Susan Frederick Gray as a teenager? And all of those folks are still ministers in different places, but they are all still ministers. And people become ministers for all kinds of reasons, and then they serve in all different kinds of ministries. There are chaplains and campus ministers and therapist counseling ministers and activists and community ministers and religious educators and parish ministers. And then within each one of those areas, folks have their own focus. Some folks only like to serve tiny, tiny churches. Some like the what we call a mega church in Unitarian Universalism. Those churches have between 1,000 and 2,000 members. We do have some that big. And some people like to serve in jails, and they serve in hospitals, and in schools and colleges and all kinds of places, and it is all ministry. For me, my primary focus is interim or transitional parish ministry. I have been trained to help congregations work through change, conflict, and uncertainty, and I love what I do. And I have colleagues who don't ever want to set foot inside a congregation, and they love what they do. You are in the process of finding a parish or congregational minister. So we'll talk a bit from that lens today. Your search committee will do much of the work on your behalf, asking questions, holding focus groups, doing congregational surveys, requesting and analyzing data, and preparing a profile of UUCD that potential ministers will be able to see starting December 1. That's why it's critical you fill out the surveys. That's where that information comes from. I'll share the things that I've learned about you and the things that we put on the whiteboards and put in our surveys. But now that you've had a chance to live through that, my hope is that we did some good work, and now you're able to say more clearly and definitively who you are as a congregation and who you want as a minister. That's the work they're going to do. And as they're creating that profile, which I think is like a Match.com profile, ministers are doing the same thing. They're preparing their own Match.com profiles, those ministers who know they're going to be looking next year. And their profile will say, these are my views on certain areas. I'm really, really good at preaching. I suck at religious education. I love administration. I don't know how to read a balance sheet. Like, whatever it is, they're going to put together their own profile, because they're looking for the right fit, just like you are. So based on these profiles, or for your side, it's called a congregational record, and for the minister, it's called a ministerial record. December 1, potential ministers will be able to see all the congregational records, and they'll get a month to look them over, and they'll start looking at your website, and they'll Google this church, and they'll look at like what kind of activities have they done, what have they been involved in. They're gonna investigate you on the sly. They'll ask their friends. They'll probably call me and say, what can you tell us about this church? They'll do all of that stuff. And then they'll tell the UUA, these are the congregations where I might consider going. And you don't get to pick 100 of them. There's a formula, so you only get to pick so many. For interim search last year, I only got to pick 6. For settled search a few years ago, the number was 15. So we don't know how many people could express interest in you, but that's what'll happen in December. Then on January 2nd, the UUA will call up your search committee and say, guess what, guys? These 5, 10, 2, 1, whatever, ministers are interested in you. They want to come to UUCD. The search committee then gets to decide who they want to interview. They might even bring in a couple of candidates for weekend visits in February and March. They'll keep you updated as to what they're doing in general terms, but they won't tell you who they're talking to. You don't know who they're interviewing. And then at the end of March, they have this thing called Match Day. This really is like a dating game. But the ministers who went and interviewed places will say, okay, so I interviewed with 5 places. In order of preference, I want to go to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And the churches will say, we interviewed these 5 candidates. And in order of preference, we want 1, 2, and the other 3 just aren't even, we don't want them. That can happen because you want to pick the person who's right for you. You don't want to just have somebody. So if the number ones line up, if the person who wants to come here is the same person you wanted to have come here, the search committee will get a call from the UUA and say, you're going to be very happy when things are announced. And that's exactly how they do it. They say, you're going to get some good news. If your number one had you down as a, I don't want to go there, then you're going to get the call that says, how much did you like number two? And that's okay. Or vice versa. There might be a minister out there who's like, I really, really, really want my number one. And they get that call that says, how do you feel about your number two? So the hope is always that one and one match up. Always. And sometimes they don't, and that's okay. It doesn't mean there's anything wrong with you or anything wrong with the minister. Did you like every single person you dated? Can you imagine if you had a first date with somebody and then, okay, you gotta get married. Don't like each other? Too bad, gotta get married. Same thing happens here. So after this match happens, if we've got one and one, that's the first time you're gonna hear a name as a congregation. You'll be told your candidate is Connie Simon. And you'll be like, who is Connie Simon? And then you'll start Googling. And you'll be digging and you'll be listening to sermons. I remember watching my YouTube stats go like through the roof the day after candidate match day. And I'm like, what happened? Oh, I get it. So that's what happens. And then you'll invite this candidate here to spend a week with you in April. They'll preach on 2 Sundays in a row. And in between those Sundays, they're going to meet everybody. They're going to have lunch with the quilting group. They're going to come to choir rehearsal. They're going to meet with the board. They're going to meet with the last 10 board presidents. They're going to meet with the kids. They're going to meet with the staff. They're going to meet with the concerned you use for Yolo County wetlands. They're going to meet with everybody. And then that second Sunday, you'll vote. This is the democratic process in Unitarian Universalism. You will vote. And if the vote is successful, you will have a new minister. And then the work becomes for the board to go sign the contract and do all that stuff. Now, I will tell you, there are many ministers who say, I'm not coming unless I get a unanimous vote or a 98% positive vote. And there's a reason why. Would you want to come someplace where 15% of the people already don't want you? That's a real thing. So, through these survey and focus groups that are happening in the next month or so, you're going to refine your wish list. Do you want someone who's good at preaching and praying and performing rites of passage like weddings and celebrations of life? Do you want someone who only does academic services? Or do you want more lively, embodied worship? Or a mixture of both? Is it someone who loves music? Will your new minister be a teacher? Will they give folks the skills, the strength, and the support that they need to be in community with others? Will they teach by example? Or will they lead classes and discussion groups? Will they be an evangelist? Now, I know some of you are probably already like, ugh, that's a charged term. Take it back to its roots. Evangelism means telling the good news. So this can mean a person who is willing to go out in public and say why Unitarian Universalism is what this world needs. Why are we good? I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I am wholeheartedly a UU evangelist because I think that's important. You'll wonder, is community what we want most in this minister? Do we want a minister whose priority is being there for us to do pastoral care? Do we want somebody who's going to just make phone calls all day and check in on us? Do we want someone who's going to do visits? Do we want someone who's going to sit by the bedside of our dying loved ones? Do you want them to spend most of their time here on campus at UUCD, or do you want them outside the congregation building relationships in Davis, in Woodland, and in larger Yolo County? Do you want them connected to the UUA, or do you want their focus to be inward only? Is it important that they're good at administration? Should they be able to understand the budget? Should they know how to supervise staff? Should they understand congregational polity and governance? It's a lot to think about what you want from your new minister. Maybe you want it all. Parish ministers in particular are also janitors, maintenance folks, pencil sharpeners, printer unjammers, potluck organizers, name tag makers, responders to midnight alarms, post-event trash emptiers, the ones who know where all the light switches are, and often the only folks who know where we keep the extra toilet paper and the candles for the Christmas Eve service. And for every person who says, oh, Reverend Connie, you shouldn't be doing that. That's not your job. There are 10 who think that's exactly your job.
The biggest one is stress. And I think that's endemic to everyone's ministry and to almost any profession these days. I mean, we're all trying to do the same or more with less.
When I first got to ministry, I laughed when I heard that ministers got a month off to recuperate. My first 2 years in ministry, I didn't take the summer off, or July off, didn't take a month off, and I was exhausted.
Cultures, institutions, just like families have cultures, and so you enter into a culture and then you have to find ways to invite it to transform the places where it's too limiting. And people don't like change. We people, all of us, don't like change. We like things to remain the same. So you're constantly, if you're inviting people to grow, inviting them to change, and that work is work that we all resist.
I think the challenges for a minister are to figure out how to lead and to be self-differentiated, but not be distant. And I think that one of the things that has been most successful for me in that was to develop a real good circle of friends outside the church, to pay special attention to getting the time off that I need. It simply allows me to be a better minister when I'm taking care of myself.
The way that I deal with challenges is that I know I'm never dealing with them alone. So there's something in me that I have to depend on, but I have a partner in my own personal life who is my spouse. I have friends, and then I have a congregation full of people, and I'm in partnership with them to overcome the challenges. The challenges would do me in if I were doing it on my own. But ministry is not a solo gig.
Again, that's an old video.
And it's oh so true. Even today, take that times 20. That ministers are tired. It's a tough time for us right now. We are tired, just like you are. There is the pandemic where ministers were doing the best they could to hold congregations together at a time when you couldn't see one another. For lots of ministers, they didn't know how to use Zoom. Our ministers are kind of aging, and there are a lot who didn't know what Zoom was, let alone how to use it for worship. So they had to learn technology and then figure out how do you do worship with this. They had to figure out how you can connect with folks when folks don't want to be connected to because they're in their own little cocoons and shells being afraid of COVID. Being afraid of our political situation, being afraid of all the stuff that was happening outside. And we're people too. We were afraid as well. Will I get COVID? What am I gonna do? I remember the day that I called the staff in and said, I am making the decision to shut down this church. I talked to the board president and I said, do you have an objection? And she said, no, it's your call. And I told the staff, pack a box because I don't know when you're coming back. And we worked from home. And we shut down the church. And sometimes that has to happen. And that's a hard call for those folks whose sole being is about coming in on Sunday and seeing their friends. It's hard. And then there's just the burnout. If you made it through COVID, now you're back and it's like, oh my God, I'm tired, but people want everything to just be like it was. But not everybody came back. So how do you do more with less volunteers? How do you do more with less money? Because as congregations age, pledge income is going down because younger folks, younger parents with families are often not able to contribute at the same level as those who are retired. It's a thing. And then there are situations where it's just not clear in the church who does what. Okay, I see some members of this board laughing. Because when I got here last year, somebody said to me, we don't know how to board. Because you'd spent many years in a situation where there weren't clear rules, where you had created systems to accommodate folks, but you didn't really have clear rules. You didn't have boundaries. There were some who were incredibly close to your ministers, like in their personal lives. And then there were others who felt like they were on the outside. If you're not in the clique, you don't get this. So there were boundary issues. And there was a lot of love. You've loved your former ministers. But still, there was a lack of boundary and clarity here that we have been working on. And that's a thing. And along with that goes, well, when you look at boundaries, what are your expectations and are they realistic? Should I be available to you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week? No. I saw a yes, but no. For the most part, I am, and I need Monday off. That's my day off, and I need it. Right now, there is a push among ministers and religious professionals to get our agreement to say that we can have 2 days off. So we can have a 5-day work week. And it's not going anywhere. It's not working. It's not working. Congregations are generally opposed to it. And we don't know if that's going to happen. But it doesn't mean that you as a congregation can't recognize that your minister needs a break sometime. So when your new minister comes, understand that. That they're trying to figure out who you are. They're trying to learn 250 names. They might be trying to figure out how to get here. Like how to move here. How to get their car registered. Getting their kid enrolled in school, if they have kids. They might be trying to figure out where do they live. They're trying to unpack boxes. They're trying to figure out where the grocery store is. So day one is not the day to say, you need to be doing this, 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 and this. Just a thought. Just a thought. Tell them a little sensitive on that one. So I want to share something from Mark Morrison Reed. He wrote this back in 2000. And I'm not going to read all of it. I'm aware of the time. He starts by talking about the baptismal font in the First Unitarian Church of Chicago building. And he says the baptismal font was older than the building. And I can't imagine that because that building is very, very old. It's on the University of Chicago campus. It is a beautiful Gothic building. But he talks about being baptized in that church and growing up a Unitarian. And that this was the church, he says, my marriage and my ordination, my mother's and sister's memorial services were all held within that community. And as the candlelight service on Christmas and the flower communion services mark the cycle of the year, these rites of passage mark the cycle that is my life. He goes on to say, I am at home among these people in this liberal religious movement. It is a place where I was nurtured, and because I was nurtured, I grew. Having grown, I could give, and having given, I grew more. It is a place where struggling, I could fail. Where failing, I was still loved. Where loved, I could begin again. It's a place where in pain, I could go. Where having gone, I was cared for. Where cared for, I could heal and go on. That is why I am a minister. To help sustain religious communities, places like the one in which I grew up, places made holy by what people experience within them, the seasons of their lives, and the healing of their souls. The power of community is enormous, and I have lived my entire life in its embrace. It's why I entered the ministry. I believe the liberal church is worth devoting a life to, my life, in fact. My years as a congregant did not prepare me, however, for a cruel irony. Ministry is a source of unrequited grief. I regret having not read the fine print. If I had, perhaps I would have made another choice, but the print was very small, the paraphrasing paradoxical, and while I was young and eager, this is what it said. You will love your parishioners with all your heart and never befriend them. You will pour out your lifeblood for the community and never settle there. You shall die to the congregation so that ministry might live. I know, deep, huh? That, to me, is the epitome of why we do this work. I do this work so that Unitarian Universalism can continue. That's why I help congregations in conflict and in transition. And it's not something that I can do alone. You have a role. Every one of you has a role. We do this together. Yes, I'm the one who wears the stole. I'm the one who has freedom of the pulpit. And each of you has a role. Ministry is what we do together. It's how we live our principles and take them out into the streets. So I want to leave you with this thing. And it's a little longer than I thought, but you got to hear this. I'm sorry. You just got to hear this. It's by Amy Petrie Shaw, and it's called God Gave Me a Word. I was talking with God the other day because we're cool like that. And God said, hey, I want you to tell people something. And I was kind of busy, so I pretended I didn't hear. And God poked me and said, I'm not kidding. Pay attention. Because while we're cool like that, we aren't that cool, and I know when I've pushed it too far. So I put my coffee cup down, and I turned around. And God said, let me hang a word around your neck so that everyone can see it. And you better speak it when you're out, because I'll know if you don't. And it will be heavy, so heavy on your soul. And a word was hung around my neck to take out to the people standing in the streets. A word was preached into my ear and laid into my mouth and burned into my heart until all I could see was the shape of the word, and the word was all. And the word was love. And God said, now get out, because you don't have all day and the word is only going to get heavier. And you've got some work yet to do. So I'm taking my word out into the world. Love, come down on this green earth. Love, come down and turn over the tables and set the world on its end. Love, make it clear that it was the word for the poor and the word for the brokenhearted, for the queer boy and the angry girl. Love is the word for late-night hookers and long-haul truckers, for heroin junkies and runaway cutters. Love is the word for all the screwed up and pushed over and too tired and I can't take it no more. Love is the word for the HIV patient and the man with no papers. Love is the word for you and me, for the saints and the sinners and the scramblers in between. Love come down and made a way for there to be a way, and then love said, we're never going back. Love said that we're all a part of something bigger, and if you can't rise with us, if you can't love with us, then you should get the hell out of the way, because we aren't going anywhere and you're in the path. Love came down for the world to know, and I'm holding out this word so even when you and God are just like that, you can't pretend that you didn't know. I cannot put it down, not for a politician spewing hatred, not for a minister vomiting out bile in the costume of a saint, not for money or for country or for kin. I'm holding my word in my mouth. Because the next time I see God, I want to be able to say, you gave me a word and I carried it just the way you asked. You gave it to me and I took it. I showed it to everyone I met. You gave it to me and I showed it to her and Ger and Z and him. I showed it to them and they and those over there. I never put it down. I can never put it down. I was talking with God the other day, because we're cool like that. And God said, hey, I want you to tell the people something. And I was still kind of busy, so I pretended like I didn't hear again. And God said, I'm not kidding. Pay attention. Because while we're cool, we aren't that cool. And I know when I may have pushed it too far. So I put my coffee cup down and I turned around. And then God gave me a word. And now I've given it to you. Start moving. Amen. Amen. Okay, we got to take an offering. We got to take an offering. Every month, as you know, we share our plate with an organization donated by or nominated by our members. Our recipient this month, nominated by Peg Swain, is the International Convocation of Unitarian Universalist Women. Peg also happens to be a member of the IWC board and serves as the organization's secretary. You'll hear more from her about this through the month. For now, here's a very, very short video from 2021 made by IWC supporter Kathy Burek on the occasion of their 10th anniversary.
Congratulations to all of us on the 10th anniversary of the founding of the International Women's Convocation through the IWC. Unitarian, Universalist, and Unitarian Universalist women across the globe have supported and learned from each other. From Transylvania to India, from the Philippines to Uganda, Bolivia to Kenya, we have shared leadership training, developed our economic and business skills, advocated for healthcare and reproductive rights, promoted education for women and girls, and worked to end violence against women and children. Because IWC exists, the world is a better place for women. Thanks to every woman who has made IWC possible. Keep up the good work.
You all know that there are many ways that you can contribute to our offering. They are on the slide. You can donate by text on the website, or you can drop a check or cash in the offering, or by mail to the church office. Our offering will now be gratefully received. Thank you for your generosity. Stay right there. There. Thank you. Let us now extinguish our chalice. We begin by extinguishing the candles of sorrow and joy. May our joys be amplified and our sorrows lessened. And we extinguish our chalice by reciting together these words. We extinguish this flame, not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These carry in our hearts until we are together again. Our closing prayer is musical. And as you listen, I invite you to think of all the ways that you minister to the world, and then go out and do it.
Go in peace, everyone.